Good evening. Welcome back to the Journal of Hand Surgery European Journal Club for our second full season. I'm delighted to have you with us this evening, and I'm delighted to have an excellent panel of experts. This season, we're doing things with a twist. We are having co-chairing of these journal clubs by different European hand societies, and we are starting in Switzerland. And so I'm really delighted that my co-chair for this evening is Daniel Herren, who needs no introduction, current Secretary General of FESH, and hailing from Zurich. Our experts today, we have Miriam Marx, also from Zurich, Esther Vogelin from Bern. We have our very own Christy Fowler from the United Kingdom, hand therapist, and our guest editor for this episode is Michel Boeckstyns from Copenhagen. So I'm going to hand over for the first part of the evening to Daniel, who's going to chair the first paper. Over to you, Daniel.
Thank you very much, Zaf. First for the invitation and second for the nice introduction. Looking forward to a vivid discussion, and we have two very interesting papers to discuss this evening around the CMC joint. I think a lot of things are happening, and it's a very vivid and interesting subject. So again, I think there's a lot of things to learn. The first paper will be presented by Ingunn Skaugrud. She's from Norway. It's about trapeziectomy with or without tendon-based adjunct, a registry-based study of 650 thumbs. We have the opportunity to have the first daughter, Maria Wilke, with us, and the possibility to discuss with her the details of that study. Ingunn, I just hand over to you and looking forward to your presentation. Thanks.
Thank you. So good evening. I have the pleasure of presenting tonight's first paper, which was published in 2022. Dr. Maria Wilke and colleagues from Stockholm published their work on trapeziectomy with or without a tendon-based adjunct, a registry-based study of 650 thumbs. The authors start by highlighting that available evidence suggests that there are no certain differences in terms of patient-reported outcome measures, PROMs, or strength after simple trapeziectomy versus trapeziectomy with a tendon-based adjunct for trapeziometacarpal arthritis. Moreover, no tendon-based trapeziectomy adjunct has proven better than others. The paper's introduction highlights the opportunity with registry studies to compare surgical methods in large samples and in real-life context, yielding generalizable results. This study is based on data in the Swedish National Healthcare Quality Registry, HAKIR. The aim of the study was to test the null hypothesis that there were no differences in improvement of PROMs or objective functional variables between trapeziectomy and trapeziectomy with a flexor carpi radialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, or abductor pollicis longus tendon adjunct. In this study, the primary outcome was pain and load 12 months postoperatively. The secondary outcomes were pain and motion without load, pain at rest, stiffness, weakness, ability to perform activities of daily living, quick dash, grip strength, and radial and palmar abduction of the first metacarpal 3 and 12 months postoperatively. This study is a registry-based study with no control group and represents level 3 evidence. The cohort demographics were well described and included 650 thumbs in 625 patients. There were 223 trapeziectomies with FCR tendon adjunct, 185 trapeziectomies with APL tendon adjunct, 183 trapeziectomies with ECRL tendon adjunct and 59 simple trapeziectomies. Inclusion criteria was simply all patients included in the extended Harkier assessment from 2011 to 2019. The exclusion criteria were concomitant major surgical procedures and secondary procedures. Minor simultaneous surgeries were not an exclusion criteria. In patients operated on bilaterally on different occasions, the second contralateral operation was excluded if it was performed within a year of the first operation. If the type of tendon adjunct was not defined or none of the methods described above were used, patients were excluded. All operated patients were issued questionnaires before and 3 and 12 months after surgery. The PROM questionnaire in Harkier includes 8 questions on 7 symptoms: pain on load, pain on motion without load, pain at rest, stiffness, weakness, numbness, cold sensitivity, and the ability to perform activities of daily life. They are scored with a Likert scale in 10 points increments ranging from 0 to 100. Higher values means worse symptoms and disability. In addition, the Quick Dash questionnaire are registered at the same time points. Grip, key pinch, and tip pinch strength and radial and palmar abduction of the first metacarpal are assessed by physiotherapists preoperatively and 3 and 12 months after surgery. A standardized manual for these measurements was used. The response rate was 31% at 3 months and 29% at 12 months for PROMs, and 67% at 3 months and 40% at 12 months for the objective physical measurements. The proportion of responses of issued questionnaires in Harkier have varied from 37 to 50% between 2014 and 2019. 215 patients had a complete set of PROM data, and there were no association between the values at baseline and the risk of missing values at 3 and 12 months, indicating a low risk of bias in the estimates. The improvement in PROMs was analyzed with Wilcox and signed rank test. The surgical methods were compared pairwise by ordinal regression, and the objective physical measures were compared pairwise by linear regression. The risk of missing values at 3 and 12 months with respect to the value at baseline was analyzed with logistic regression. Confidence intervals and p-values were adjusted using the 2K-Kramer method to account for multiple testing. There was clinically significant improvement in all PROM variables for all methods. Ordinal regression indicated that the adjusted odds ratio for improvement of PROM in general were in favor of APL. However, worth to mention here is that pairwise ordinal regression does not define the size of the difference in improvement. The APL tendon adjunct had better odds for improvement of pain on load, motion, and weakness than trapeziectomy, trapeziectomy with FCR tendon adjunct, or trapeziectomy with ECRL tendon adjunct. It also had better odds for improvement of pain at rest and quick dash than the ECRL tendon adjunct. And it had better odds for improvement of ADL than FCR and ECRL tendon adjunct. There were no differences regarding stiffness. And the authors note that there were relatively few trapeziectomies and consequently weak statistical analysis can contribute to the lack of differences between trapeziectomy and other methods. The values for strength and for radial and palmar abduction of the thumb improved significantly in the whole group, but the differences were small. Also, there were no differences between methods regarding improvement of any of the strength parameters. For range of motion, the only significant difference were that palmar abduction improved more after FCR tendon adjunct as well as trapeziectomy compared with ECRL tendon adjunct at 12 months. However, the differences were small and within expected measurement error and probably clinically irrelevant. In summary, this comparison showed that all methods yielded clinically relevant improvement in PROM scores, but that pairwise comparisons implied an advantage of APL adjunct over FCR and ECRL adjunct and trapeziectomy. It found no differences between trapeziectomy, FCR, or ECRL adjunct. However, like I mentioned previously, pairwise ordinal regression does not define the size of the difference in improvement. Thus, it's not certain that the difference in odds ratio corresponded to a clinically relevant difference. For the strength, the increase was small, but it exceeded estimated minimal clinical important difference for women with osteoarthritis for all methods. It found no difference between methods. Trapeziectomy had statistically better range of motion than ECRL at 12 months, but the difference was small and the authors considered it irrelevant. The comparisons were impaired by the low number of trapeziectomies, and the lack of difference can at least partly be explained by a lack of power in the statistical analysis. Registry studies have the advantage of providing large samples and results reflecting the clinical reality. Conversely, they are retrospective and heterogeneous, including different centers and surgeons with varying level of expertise. There are only women in the sample, which restricts the generalizability of the results. Another weakness is the lack of specific information of the surgical procedure, as well as the high number of missed data. The result in loss of precision in the estimation of differences, as well as in loss of power with risk of underestimation of differences. To finish off, there's no conclusion, and that leads me to my finishing question. Should we discontinue the use of tendon adjuncts? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ingrid, for this nice and comprehensive overview and summary of that study. Let's jump directly into the discussion. Esther, with your broad experience clinically, does it reflect the reality you see daily with your patients?
No, actually, not at all. I was very surprised that there was no difference, first of all, in between the different tendon adjuncts that have been used, and also that the trapeziectomy was not worse than the tendon adjuncts. I know that this has never been proven in literature, but when I think about to do a trapeziectomy in a 45-year active lady, I never would do that just as a trapeziectomy, but I would always use a tendon adjunct. That's my clinical status.
So you doubt about the clinical results. Miriam, are registry data suited to answer our clinical questions?
Yeah, very good question. I think registry are very good and have the high potential to answer very different clinical questions. And that's a big advantage of registry, that they collect data from different settings, from different patients, from different clinics, like in Sweden. But I think there's the risk of wrong interpretation of the data if you have so high sample sizes. And this article is a good example of the issue with the interpretation. As you see from Ingrid's presentation, she showed a table that there's a highly significant increase in key pinch between baseline and follow-up. The increase is 0.3 kilogram. Do you think that it's clinically relevant, an increase of 0.3 kilograms? I don't think so, although the p-value provided a highly significant result. So we have to be very careful when we analyze high samples that would lead to significant p-values. And the other thing is, with the range of motion, an increase of 3 degrees in abduction is highly significant. I think it's just measurement error.
Okay, so there are a lot of question marks around these data. Maria, you're working with this registry and you have a long tradition of sampling registry data in Sweden. Can you give any comments on, you know, the quality of registry data? Is it mandatory? Do people have to deliver? Where do you see the strengths and the weaknesses of registry data in your country?
That's a large question. Well,
short answer, but precise.
It's not mandatory at all, but most hand surgical centers aim to do it, and for the patients, it's not mandatory. I think we must be aware of that it's still early days for these registries, and I mean, as we've talked about, the low response rate is. It's a known problem, and that's common in all, I mean, PROM-based questionnaires registries. So that's something we have to work on. But still, as Miriam addressed, even though it's a low response rate, there's still a lot of patients. So many times, not very small differences become statistically significant, even though they're not clinically irrelevant. But I think we address this problem in the manuscript. But I mean, I think the strength is that we can, it's doable to compare, like in this case, several different methods of surgery. That would be really difficult to perform a controlled comparison.
Okay, I think it's very interesting. So Michel, you were the editor at the time where this paper has been published, and you had it on your desk, you approved it. You see, you know, there are some doubts about methodology. Can you give us a little bit insight, you know, on what based was your decision to publish this very interesting paper indeed? Can you give us a little bit the secrets, you know, what do you see in that publication?
Accepted this paper and edited it because I think it is very important to work with registries, and it has not been done a lot in hand surgery publications. There are only very few registries. That's why I accepted it. For me, the paper shows something about registries more than about TMC arthritis. And what it shows to me is that there are a huge number of patients getting in the system, 650, and are very few that are coming out at the follow-up, down to 195. So it tells, first of all, it tells Sweden who does what in which center. And it appears that it is very different. Some people do one thing, one adjunct, the other ones do other things. It's very different. That's a fact, and that's an interesting information. Whether any of these tendon adjuncts are better than trapeziectomy alone, it does not answer that question. The number of trapeziectomies are very low, and we don't know who does what and who compares with what. So that doesn't really answer that question. And I would say to Esther, she should have changed her strategy already in 1997 when the first publications came, the prospective controlled trials that showed that trapeziectomy alone are better off than that trapeziectomy with tendon interposition. That has been done by Tim Davis, and it has been repeated and repeated and repeated. And I cannot understand that people still use tendon interpositions. It's so outdated and irrational. Anyway, that's
so Michel,
what I wanted to say.
The strong advertisement for trapeziectomy alone, but let's swing back to the paper, because I think we all need more data to really answer that question, to be honest, because all of us, having done some trapeziectomy in their career, see differences between patients. I completely agree with Esther. You know, we are probably comparing apples with pears as a classical one. Christy, sampling such data in daily activities, can you give any insights? You know, where do you see the problems? Because what we see here is, you know, it was announced in the title, 650 people. We're talking about data from one third of them. Reflects this the clinical reality, the problems in to collect data?
I think it honestly does really reflect the problems associated with collecting data, and it's something that, you know, as therapists we struggle with on a daily basis, and often the challenge of collecting kind of the PROMS data and our objective measures and our strength measures and our goniometry measures and all of the above in a short space of time in a clinical treatment session is a challenge, and trying to get patients to kind of then continue on with that. And I think it's an interesting thought that actually looking at the paper, that most of the outcomes were, at least the objective outcomes, were collected by therapists, but actually as part of the registry we didn't really look at actually that other aspect of actually the rehabilitation after the surgery, and you know, was there differences there. And I think that, you know, registries are a great thing, and it would be fabulous to have a combined therapy and surgical registry where you could actually track the patient journey, so you could really honestly look at actually what made the difference. for those patients.
Yeah, I think it's a big challenge there. No. You know, in terms of methodology, Miriam, do we have the right outcome measurements possibilities? I mean, I see even in that paper, 2022, there's still the quick dash in it. Is this appropriate?
I am a little bit allergic on the dash and quick dash. It's still the most frequently one used in thumb osteoarthritis studies. But I think it's so unspecific because it covers the function of the elbow and the shoulder. So why should we use an outcome measure for shoulder in the hand? It's, in my opinion, it's not appropriate. In this study, they used a self-developed questionnaire, which is regularly used in the Swedish registry. But we have the problem that we cannot compare our data with the Swedish data. So it's very important that we all use the same outcome measures in our studies, in our registries. And maybe you've heard from the ICHOM initiative, they developed a core set to measure outcomes for different hand disorders. And the problem with the ICHOM core set is that it's still quite long. For thumb CMC osteoarthritis, they recommend to use the full Michigan hand outcome questionnaire, which is 37 questions for both hands, so it's very long. And the developers know these issues, and it would be very good if we have shorter version, and that can lead us to the second paper with the computer adaptive testing from Rakshan, which we discuss later on.
Don't steal my bridge.
Sorry. I'm sorry. Okay.
This was a spoiler.
Okay. So my message, please, no dash. Please use outcome measures that is recommended to be and used in other institutes.
So Esther, are you part of the ICHOM family?
No.
Why not?
Because as Miriam already said, it's very difficult to get at all PROMs in a certain amount of time, pre-op, post-op, and at the end of the follow-up. So we are still looking for the really relevant PROMs. And I'm a big fan of PSFAS because this gives a bit more subjective, personalized outcome measures than the generalized PROMs we have to use. And I still look for the right thing to compare. So I also get an answer why I should take ECRL or why I should take just a trapeziectomy in a certain thumb condition in a certain patient. This is certainly not yet answered.
Michel, can an editor, can the journal play a role in selecting outcome instruments? Can we set there any standards?
Sorry. Well, you can, but I think it should be at a higher level. This decision must be taken. The journal cannot, I think so. I did a decision for the editor-in-chief, but I think the journal cannot ask for a certain PROM and no more in every paper. Because these articles come from different countries. Different countries have different traditions. Many, many people know the quick dash, what does it stand for? A quick dash 54, that's not very good. A quick dash 12, that's a very good score. So that in that sense, you cannot eliminate one PROM to instead of another one. You should have those that people are familiar with, those that people use, and that are not controversial, I would say.
Thank you very much. My two last questions, one go to Maria. What would you do differently today if you would do the study again?
Well, I mean, this is a registry study. So, I mean, the outcomes, we didn't choose it. It's given by the registry. I think I would have done the same thing. I just wish it's been maybe in 10 years ahead. So we had a lot more trapeziectomies and more data. I still think we did what we could to secure the quality and do a relevant analysis and take into account the loss of follow-up. So in this study, I don't think I could have done it otherwise. Maybe I would use another statistical method, but it wouldn't show any other result, I think.
Thank you. Ingun, I give you the last word. You were presenting the paper and working so hard on it. Does it change your daily practice being a fellow here and seeing different surgeons doing different techniques? And now we have a studies giving that result. What are your thoughts? You go home tomorrow, no, and what are you doing?
Well, it depends a little bit, but I mostly do with an adjunct, with an FCR adjunct. It's my main method. And I don't think it changes my daily practice, no.
That's a strong word. Let's put it that way. Miriam already said it, you know. I think there's still a long way to go. We heard it from Michel. I think it's a very good observation and remark that we have to respect the different possibilities in different countries for collecting data. We should be, of course, we should be critic against all these results, but discussing it, but respect it as well and try to put it in a clinical context. Nevertheless, I think the future belongs to newer outcome measure possibilities. And one of them will be presented in the second paper. And I'm happy to hand over to Zaf for the introduction for that paper. Thank you so much for the discussion for the first paper. It was very interesting.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel, and everyone for a very interesting discussion, which leads us nicely on to tonight's second paper, which is about computerized adaptive testing of symptom severity. So interesting concept, interesting piece of research, and I hope you will find an interesting paper. So I would like to introduce Malik Raisi, who is a BSSH National TIG Fellow in Manchester, who's going to present this paper. Malik.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. The second paper, we will be discussing will be computerized adaptive testing of symptom severity, a registry-based study of 924 patients with trapeziometacarpal arthritis, published in the Journal of Hand Surgery in March of this year by authors from Oxford, Warwick, Swansea, and Cardiff. The authors start by highlighting the difficulties with assessing trapeziometacarpal osteoarthritis outcomes. Whilst PROMs are validated, there can be fluctuations in the severity of symptoms, and trying to capture these with increased frequency of sampling can be burdensome to the patient. Moreover, many PROMs, such as the patient evaluation measure, are ordinal or ranked, which makes it difficult to apply and use statistical tests. They propose that computerized adaptive testing, or CAT, can make PROMs shorter and more patient-centered. This study used outcomes data from the British Society of Surgery of the Hand UK Hand Registry. The UK Hand Registry is a database which allows surgeons to record operative cases and outcomes for audit and appraisal purposes. The study used outcome data for patients with trapeziometacarpal OA. Patients completed a patient evaluation measure at baseline, 3, 6, and 12 months post-treatment, which constituted a complete data set. Incomplete data sets were mostly missing item 4 of the PEM, which was added in 2001 by Diaz et al. And incorporated into the registry only in 2017. And item 4 refers to the duration of pain. This resulted in 2,434 data sets from 924 patients. Computerized adaptive testing is effectively a computer-based test where the questions asked are tailored to the participant's previous responses. In the context of PROMs, a patient answers a single question from the outcome measure. The next question presented to them is chosen by the algorithm, depending on what they answered for the first question. The aim is that this process can get to the same overall score by asking fewer questions. It has been used in the past to streamline general well-being measures, such as the V12, as well as disease-specific outcome measures, such as the cleft Q for cleft lip on palate. Here's an example to demonstrate how CAP works, and I'd like to thank Rakshan Cameron, the lead author of the paper, for this slide. So let's say an individual completes a PROM which assesses pain with mobility. If this individual reports pain with walking, then we can estimate that this person has pain with running and jumping. And at this point, it isn't useful to ask every single question in the PROM. It's more informative to ask questions which discriminate between pain associated with the lower levels of mobility. And CAP does this intelligently to personalize questions for each patient based on their previous responses. The original registry data was used to create the algorithm. This was then tested using a Monte Carlo simulation where 1,000 computer-generated response sets were simulated and analyzed by the algorithm. The first question used was question 8, and then a total score was predicted based on their responses. The next most useful question was selected by the algorithm and so on, and this continued until a threshold precision was reached. The validity of this new score was then assessed by comparing it to the original score. Now, as the PEM scores produced ordinal or ranked data, they can't be directly or statistically compared to the numerical CAT score. The item response theory approach produced an intermediate score, the IRT-based patient evaluation measure. The fit between the original and intermediate IRT scores were assessed using a range of statistical tools, and then the IRT and CAT scores were then assessed. These are the registry patient characteristics: an average of 64 years, the majority female, and most either having a simple trapeziectomy or a trapeziectomy with associated soft tissue or prosthetic procedure. When looking at the validity of the test, starting with the comparison between the original score and the IRT-based score, the fit statistics on the simulated cohort showed adequate fit. Now, tests 1 and 2 here assess fit, so a score of 1 demonstrates a good fit and 0 a bad fit, whereas tests 3 and 4 assess misfits, the opposite is the case, and a score of 0 is desirable. They also found that item 10, which assessed hand appearance, did not combine well with any of the other questions in the PEM, but this was not severe enough to justify removing it from the model. If we look at the second comparison between the IRT score and the CAT score, again, these scores correspond well. We're aiming for a score of 1 for Pearson's correlation coefficient and low error scores. Finally, the performance of the CAT algorithm itself. This reduced the number of questions required to a median of 2, down from the initial 11 with a range of 1 to 4 questions. The graph here shows an example of a test where only 2 questions were required to reach the threshold precision. The scores have been converted to a 0 to 100 scale with the true score as 57, which is represented by the red dotted line. The first question was a question 8, followed by question 3, which corresponds to an overall score of 54 over 100, which is within the precision limit. So in summary, the authors have created a CAT version of the patient evaluation measure, which reduces the time required to collect data. They also propose a system where this can be used via a smartphone app to achieve a much higher frequency of data collection. The authors describe limitations, first of the CAT process itself, where CAT studies assume that the order questions asked do not influence the responses. The training data used also limit generalizability to British patients with trapeziometacarpal OA. Moreover, the registry data itself may not be generalizable, being limited to surgeons who engage with and submit data to the registry. Thank you for your attention. I'd like to hand back to the panel for discussion.
Brilliant, thank you. Thank you, Malik. Very well presented, and it really helps us understand the concept and the study that that then ensued from that concept. So I'm gonna go straight to Miriam, actually, for her thoughts on this study, the concept behind it and how it was conducted in your view.
So I think it's a very good study. Congratulations to Rakshan and team. You did it very well, and you described the process of computerized adaptive testing quite clear so that it's understandable for readers who are not familiar with this technique. And I think, as I mentioned before, computerized adaptive testing is the future of PROMS. It's outdated to show patients a set of 30, 50 questions. And if we now have these algorithms, it's so much easier for the patient. It's time, more time saving for the person who administers the questionnaire. But what I think is, or what I would like to know from Rakshan, how is it for smaller medical practices, medical offices, can they use computerized adaptive testing? Because you need tablets, you need the software, probably you need a data manager. What do you think? Is it also suitable for smaller practices?
Yeah, so yeah, thank you for those comments about our paper. And I think that's a really important point about smaller practices. So for what we're doing next is operationalizing the software as a smartphone app. And the smartphone app has capabilities so that it's used on patients' own devices. So rather than having the burden on the clinic to set up a system and hand tablets to people, patients themselves will get a notification on their personal device through something like email to complete the CAT. They would open it up on their own phone, complete the two questions, and then they'd be done. And then also the one comment that we discussed in the paper was the thought about older adults and the smartphone use among older adults. And we looked at a document from Deloitte actually, which showed that the smartphone use among older adults is increasing year by year. So we're hoping that this would be a way to sort of decrease burden on the clinic to set something up, and it can just make it very personalized to each individual patient for their personal device.
Nice. Thank you. Thank you, Kamran. And where did the actual concept come from? The idea that, you know, before you undertook this study, what's the original research that's been going on to for you to have then applied this to hands and thumb arthritis?
Yeah, so it's kind of interesting, actually. Like, computerized adaptive testing is not a new thing in general. It's actually been used over several decades in the fields of education. So for example, standardized testing like the LSAT, which is the law school admission test in the US, the MCAT as well, which is the medical one in the US and Canada. So really these methods of psychometrics and computerized adaptive testing were from education. And it's only recently that they've been started to be applied in medicine and in health research. So the idea to apply this in surgery, and specifically hand surgery, was because, you know, we all know that PROMs are useful, but we have this problem of infrequent administration, which affects the data that we're able to get from them, but then also burden for patients to complete these questionnaires, and also burden on clinicians to, you know, remember to administrate them and score them manually. So we were really applying these methods, which are tried and true in a different field, and we're now just working on them in hand surgery. One of the members of our team also worked on computerized adaptive testing for cleft lip and palate a few years ago. So it was I guess an interest among our team that we're pretty keen on working.
Thank you. Christy, from a therapist perspective, could I have your thoughts on this study?
Yeah, I think this is a fabulous study, and I think it's something that, you know, could very well kind of revolutionize the way that we're actually using PROMs and potentially giving us kind of and computerizing it and giving us more robust data that actually we may be able to kind of monitor real life trends with changes in outcomes, you know, in individual clinics, and, you know, thinking pipe dreams here. But I think it's fabulous. But I just one of the questions I kind of had around this is, obviously, you know, in order to do the CAT testing, we have such a range of PROMs available for use, and we know that many are not particularly fit for purpose. Do we have to go through all the same testing, and do we have to have a large cohort of data available from individual PROMs in order to be able to develop this amongst the other problems that are potentially being used?
Yeah, so I think that's a really important question, because from what we did to apply computers adaptive testing, I think the number that our team aims is around 500 individuals to apply these methods to have enough patients that we can then simulate responses for and create a CAT algorithm for. So you do need, I would say, a large sample to adequately perform these analyses. And I do agree with you that the variation in problems used is a bit of a difficulty in comparing between studies and then also different clinics. So one thing that we're hoping to do with the CAT that we developed is have it be a part of the UK Hand Registry. And we're aiming to sort of make it a bit more accessible and more standardized. But yeah, I think that's a really good point about the variation and then also the number required to do something like this for other problems.
Yeah. Can I just make one more comment, I guess, and thinking around, you know, there's lots of talk around the use of smartphones and computer technology and thinking around kind of older adults. But I think we have to always consider as well that perhaps that's not the group that we really need to be thinking about. And we're really thinking about the, you know, the social health equality. And, you know, it's perhaps our, you know, itinerant homeless patients that don't have access to those. And that's not always that older adult group, and how we can kind of think about, you know, with the more technology we create to do all of these things for us, that potentially we start creating even more inequality in what we're, the data that we're gathering as well.
Really good point.
Can I ask you then, just a question? What's your role then as therapist, or what could be your role in that? You know, the interesting thing is you as a therapist, you see the patients much more often than we surgeons do.
Yeah.
So I wonder, you know, if there would be a possibility to have your observation included in such prompts as well. You know, it's just a completely different concept. But I'm sure the differences are even more obvious for you than probably for a surgeon seeing the patient two or three times after surgery.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, it's one of the challenges for us as therapists. And if I kind of go back and I think it was Esther that you talked about the use of the patient specific functional scale, and that's something that we use, and it's a very independent prom where anyone's not used it, where we ask a patient to name a task that they have difficulty with and rank on a 0 to 10 scale, and then we go back throughout therapy and re-rank that. So it's a prom based on their personal function. And I guess if we're thinking around our like individualized care and things, you know, we have to think about that. But I think the kind of the therapy observations for the vast majority of things are actually our objective measures that are taking there, our goniometry measurements, our strength measurements, and all of those kind of things. And also our kind of, I guess, observation of muscular movements and patterns of movements. And I think some of those are the things that potentially we're not capturing so well in outcomes at the moment.
Thank you, Christy. Before I come to Esther, there's a couple of questions from our audience. I have a question for you, Kamran, from Lambros Athanatos. I hope I've pronounced that correctly. Could you explain what actually happens in real time when a patient is filling out the questionnaire? Is the number of questions asked predetermined, or does it depend on how they reply to the first two questions?
Yes, that's a really good question. So when a patient would fill this out, they would get a question that's on the middle of the scale at about a medium level difficulty. Then how they respond to that question will determine the next question that's presented to them. So the questions that they're given are personalized to how they respond to prior questions. And this continues until a standard error of measurement of less than 0.3 is met. So for our study, we found that patients were administered between 1 and 4 questions with a mean and median of 2 questions presented. So they're personalized and based on the previous responses, and will continue until a reliability threshold is met.
Great. And another question from Turkey, from Hande Usta. She says, is the algorithm a kind of artificial intelligence, or did you use machine learning or a different deep learning method?
Yeah, so computerized adaptive testing is a form of artificial intelligence. So the computer studied the registry data that we had about how individuals responded. So actually, like, the way that the CAT did this was it looked at each individual person and looked at each individual item responses one at a time. And then the CAT would predict what the individual's next response would be to sort of learn how people were responding. And then we tested the algorithm on a new set of simulated patients. So yeah, computerized adaptive testing is a form of artificial intelligence.
Lovely, thank you. So Esther, I mean, the robots are coming and they're going to decide whether you're going to operate or not by the looks of things going forward. How do you feel about this? Artificial intelligence may end up determining whether you carry on operating ultimately, or, I mean, that's being very cynical. What are your thoughts?
My thoughts are, or let's face my experience with prompts and patients so far is that actually many patients have to be educated to fill in the prompts, not correctly, but in their way. They are not used to quantify their pain. They are not used to tell us what is really their problem. And I think one danger could be when we just reduce the questions that we may not get the answer that is really reflecting the problem of the patient. The less question we ask, I disagree a little bit with Miriam, who says it's a burden. Of course it's a burden, but for the patient, this burden sometimes, in my experience, helps to define his or her problem. And the least questions you use, the more danger it is that you don't get the problem out of the patient.
Okay. So, Cameron, do you want to comment upon that in terms of, at first sight, asking very few questions is probably also not going to be very accurate in terms of a result, an outcome.
Yeah, I can see how it could seem that, you know, we're asking less questions. We might not be getting everything that we need. But for our specific study, we found that some of the questions in the PEM actually weren't really representative of the underlying construct. So item number 10, looking at hand appearance, while the other questions on the scale look at different constructs. For our specific study, sometimes asking more questions, but the quality of those questions might not be measuring the underlying construct that the prompt measures, can reduce the quality of the measurement that we have. And then also for our CAT, what it did was predict the respondent's total score with a fewer number of questions. So it's maintaining the same level of accuracy for the underlying construct being measured with less questions. So it's kind of finding a balance between burden, but then also precision of measurement. And that's where we worked on with programming it so that the standard error of measurement was less than 0.3. And that's how the CAT decided when to stop administering more questions.
Thank you. So Michel, I'd like to come to you because you obviously received the paper, you would have edited it and accepted it. So could you give us your thoughts in terms of what you first thought when you first saw the paper? Did it take you not long to understand what was going on, or did you have to read it a few times? And
I realized what it was about from the beginning, but yes, I had to read it a few times before I was really into it. And I have done some job in making it more readable by asking for revisions by the authors. And that's the final product that came out here. I think it's a very good thing, a very good paper and a very interesting topic. And you must realize that this is all about constructing a method of measuring a latent trait, something that it cannot be defined very clearly by measurements otherwise. Also, which means what is a good hand or what is a good thumb or something like that. This kind of prompts try to define that and the IRT, IRT theory, the item response theory, constructs a questionnaire that is coherent, where each question asks the same in the same direction, not here and there and up and down. They are all pointing at the same thing and trying to quantify that thing. That is what the IRT and what this prompt is trying to do, and that's very important. It doesn't say it applies to everything. It should be tested again to whether it applies to, let's say, DRUJ motion or whatever. But it is a very good start, and it has proven here to be useful in TMC osteoarthritis and making it a short, concise way of measuring how bad is the arthritis. It will never, ever be enough to make the decision whether to operate or not, as has been asked. This decision must be based on very different things. It must be based on, of course, on a judgment on how bad is the condition, what are the expectations of the patients, what are the alternatives, and at the end, it's a shared decision made by the patient and the doctor, of course. So artificial intelligence is still stupid, I would say. It's a low IQ. There is a future here, and we must keep on working on it. And I applaud the paper.
Thank you. Thanks, Michel. Danny?
Allow me a comment. You know, I think we're talking about prompts. And as already Michel just said, is the decision is individual A, and B, it's based on different things. So it's not only the prompts. And I agree with Esther. No, I never forget the patient we were following up for insurance reason with filling out the prompt every 2 or 3 weeks, the same questionnaire. You cannot imagine how much variance was within, you know, not reflecting what clinically went on, you know, and it was obvious as well for the therapist following this patient very closely, as well for our surgeon. So we had a hard time to explain the insurance company, listen, it's going better and better, and we can prove that. There was no way with prompts to prove that. So I think we should not forget that, you know, there are many different things coming in, and things just mentioned by Miriam, that we have to look at the results, how clinically relevant are they, you know? She mentioned 3 degrees of differences in mobility. Who cares? You know, certainly not the patient, maybe the statistician.
Oh, we've lost Danny there for a second. Cameron, can I ask you about the costs then? So when will we see this in a high street near us anytime soon? And you know, because I imagine it's a big project that you've done, that lots of people involved, lots of expensive machines. You know, what is the reality of rolling this out, and the kind of costs if a hospital, a department, or a you know, individual wanted to use this for their patients?
That's a really good question. We're actually starting to test out the app right now in a sample of patients with thumb-based osteoarthritis, but then also in hand trauma, which we also validated the CAT for. What we're doing is we're doing qualitative interviews with patients to test the feasibility and acceptability, also looking at different scheduling regimes. In terms of the cost, I think because it's so based off of the patient and it's housed on you know, the patient's phone and it's a notification that they get, I would have to maybe think about that a bit more, about what specific clinic or hospital is looking to implement it, what their procedures are around things like data security, if that has an influence on any of those costs. But generally right now it's very low cost because it's all on the patient's phone and it's a notification that they get. But then I would have to think more about specific settings if there are additional requirements that might need to be reviewed.
I imagine there must be software licenses and the effort that's been put into the actual product would need to be recouped, I'm sure. But that's Danny, you've got your hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, in that surrounding, Esther, do you see a value of such questionnaires preparing the first visit of the patient to your clinic? Now, we're always talking about outcome, but probably we could reverse it and coming in much earlier with such questionnaires in order to also, we already said it, expectations, very important issue, understand what the problems of the patients are.
Yes, I think this is a very good point. I think it helps the patient to reflect his problem in advance before he sees the therapist or the surgeon, when he has a couple of questions and to think about what is actually my problem apart from the pain. What would I have? What would I want to have better or whatever? It's not just the pain in the. And sometimes even for patients, it's very difficult to differentiate their pain. So I think having such a questionnaire, I think they reflect their problem much better.
Michel, any thoughts on that? You have to unmute. Sorry, Michel.
So, in the clinic where I've been working in Gentofte, we monitored the TMC1, the TMC patients with quick dash. In that way, we operate them, we see them after 3 weeks. If everything seems okay, we don't make further appointments. But the system sends them to their email, the quick dash every 3 months. And automatically, if the after 6 months, if the quick dash has not fallen below a certain value, we call in the patient for check. So this goes automatically, and that's a way of using these prompts in the follow up.
Christy.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point, Michael, that I kind of think mentioned a little bit earlier in being able to monitor change with patients. And I think it's really about understanding that the PROMs are really about the patient's thoughts about their own condition, not necessarily our clinical opinion of what's good or not. And, you know, we might certainly see a patient, particularly with CMCG.
Oh, you've muted.
Sorry, a patient that comes to us who, on an x-ray looks absolutely awful. You get the patient in front of you who's got, a Z deformity, and you think, how is this patient actually functioning? And then you put a quick dash in front of them and they score really low. And so I think that's really important to kind of think about that actually, these PROMs are really not comparable amongst patients. And, just because one patient scores a 50 on a quick dash and a 50 by the next patient, it's in no way comparable to actually what's happening with those individual patients.
Thank you. Thank you, Christy. Thank you. I think we're coming up to time in terms of wrapping up tonight. I'd like to thank all our experts and our fellows for two beautiful presentations. Ingun and Malik, thank you so much. I'm going to give the final word to Daniel, who's co-chaired all the way from Zurich with his Swiss colleagues. And I hope the experience of a jointly chaired journal club has been fruitful, and particularly for the Swiss hand surgeons. Daniel.
Thank you very much, Zaf, again, for the invitation. Very important subject. I think we always learn. As usual, after such an hour, we have more questions than answers, which I think is the purpose of such sessions. But nevertheless, it gives a lot of stimulation. And we see there's still a long road ahead of us, but there are very interesting things coming up, including this computerized, if you call it artificial intelligence or not. And I think we are more and more forced to put clinical experience observational things from therapy and the patients you together to gather a real complete as possible pictures of a patient before, during and after his treatment. So I think again, very stimulating. Thanks a lot to all of us, especially also the presenting authors. I'm very happy that the first authors of the papers were here. It's always nice to have their original voices. Thank you very much also, Michel. It's a big honor to have you here on the panel. And thanks to all of you, and I wish you a nice evening, and hope to see you again soon.
Thank you. Goodbye from all of us.